pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Throughout our lives, we tend to move towards something that gives us hope, happiness, or contentment. Whether explicit or implied, at an early age, we're taught that it's possible to live a fairy tale life, where life is perfect, you get what you want, and then you live happily ever after. We look forward to the next best thing, the next highlight, the pinnacle, the ultimate moment, the greatest event that changes everything and our lives drastically improve. As a young child, you can't wait to start kindergarten, and then middle school and high school. You look forward to the time when you become a teenager, get your driver's license, and then graduate high school, followed by college. Those moments come and they go. Then you look forward to landing a great job. Maybe you look forward to getting married, having children, buying a house, buying a bigger house, being promoted, making more money, having grandchildren, retiring, and traveling. We're looking for that one incident when we think our purpose in life will be fulfilled, when our story is complete. Oftentimes, what happens when we reach that pinnacle that we've been eagerly anticipating, we find out that it wasn't all we expected it to be. It was okay, but it wasn't fantastic. What's worse is when the event includes an unpleasant aspect. Let me tell you a story of a couple who was looking forward to a pinnacle in their lives. I was officiating a marriage for a couple in their mid to late 60s. It was the second marriage for both of them. It was a very small and intimate wedding with just their children and grandchildren, about 20 people in attendance. Following the ceremony, we gathered at the Barton Creek Country Club in Austin for a meal. And afterwards, they had the traditional cutting of the cake. And that's when the groom took a piece of cake and shoved it into his new bride's face. It was tense, it was awkward, and it was uncomfortable for all of those present. Silence filled the room. The bride stood dumbfounded and humiliated. And she finally broke the silence, saying, "I cannot believe you did that to me. No one has ever been so disrespectful to me." It was a day they had looked forward to, but as it turned out, it wasn't the highlight they were expecting. I learned a lesson from that event. I went home and added to my list of topics to discuss in pre-marriage classes, talk with bride and groom about cutting the cake. And I always share that story. Our lives do not revolve around one specific peak moment or one act in our story. There's always a new adventure and another act waiting for our participation. There is always another chapter that we co-write with God. Life is not perfect. We do not always get what we want. We may not always be happy, but we can still live a great life. Today we continue the story of Joseph, who was adored by his father and despised by his brothers. 17-year-old Joseph told his brothers about his dreams of one day ruling over them. When they were in the fields shepherding the flock, the brothers sold Joseph into slavery, and he was taken to Egypt. After many twists and turns, ups and downs, Joseph interpreted Pharaoh's dreams, explaining that God would bring about 7 years of a plentiful harvest, followed by 7 years of famine. Impressed by his wisdom, Pharaoh put Joseph in charge of collecting, storing, and distributing the harvest. Following the 7 years of famine, Jacob, Joseph's father, learned there was grain in Egypt, so he sent his sons to buy some. It was only the youngest son, Benjamin, who remained at home with his father. When the brothers arrived in Egypt, they bowed down to Joseph because he was the governor of the land. They didn't recognize Joseph, but Joseph recognized his brothers. His dreams had finally come true. He was in a position of power over his brothers, requiring them to bow down before him. So, is that the end of the story? Or are there other wants and desires that will keep Joseph moving forward in his life? Joseph concocted an elaborate scheme to get his brothers to go home to Canaan and then return to Egypt, bringing his father and his brother in tow. And finally, Joseph reveals his identity to his brothers, weeping so loudly that his entire household wondered what was happening. The big reveal was followed by lots of hugging, kissing, and crying, just like at a family reunion. And Joseph said to them, "I am your brother, the one you sold in Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves. God sent me before you to save lives. God sent me before you to make sure you'd survive and to rescue your lives in this amazing way. You didn't send me here. It was God who made me a father to Pharaoh, master of his entire household, and ruler over the whole land of Egypt." Joseph could have sought revenge, but instead he forgave his brothers and reconciled with them. What happened to Joseph years earlier hadn't changed, but Joseph had no ill will towards his brothers. In light of his greatest ally, God, always being with him, Joseph understood his story from a new perspective. There was a lot of hardship and suffering in his life, yet he was able to find meaning and purpose in those painful events that led to his healing and transformation. I love this quote by Pastor Sarah Heath, who says, "Things always look different on the other side of grace." Things always look different on the other side of grace. Do you ever feel that the greatest part of your story has already passed? Do you grab hold of those countless opportunities that God gives you? Pastor Heath tells a story about Miss Charlotte, who is in her 90s. She said, "Miss Charlotte sat in my office sharing with me a deep desire to start a new Bible study and fellowship group for people over 90. She said she had realized that she had been feeling like her story was over. 'I know that can't be true,' said Miss Charlotte, 'because I'm still here. I want to help other people dream about the things we are uniquely capable of because of our age.' As she left the office, she said, 'I still have a couple of chapters to write with God.'" Although our wants and desires are what motivates us, what really counts in living a great story is our actions. I had this desire to learn how to be a travel photographer as a hobby. I've purchased the equipment I need, but I haven't taken any classes to learn the basics of photography. If I want to fulfill that desire, I need to be intentional about creating moments that will help me move forward in my life. I need to prepare for the next act in my story. What is one of your desires? And what have you done to fulfill that desire? What moments can you create that will help you move forward in your life? Pastor Heath writes, God never directly talks to Joseph. Joseph is so sure God has been acting in his life. And yet there is no burning bush, no men showing up telling him what to do, no divine promises, not even any wrestling with God. Joseph, like most of us, must look at his story and figure out the places where God has been present. He co-wrote the story with God by pursuing good desires, living into the roles he had been given, growing through conflict, living faithfully in whatever circumstances he found himself, and finding redemption in the many plot twists of his life. Joseph's story isn't perfect, but it is great. How about you? What good desires are you pursuing? Which God-given roles are you learning to live into? In what ways are you growing through conflict? Are you seeking redemption in your plot twists? Because as long as we have breath, there is always another act in the great story we are co-writing with God. Let us pray. Holy God, you invite us to live in your ways, and you give us to each other to know and love as we co-write our stories with you. Show us your will. Help us listen to your urgings with prayerful hearts, and give us the courage to follow through in ways that bring you honor and glory.